blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Sovereign Lord, you brought your servant Alfred to a troubled throne, that he might establish peace in a ravaged land and revive learning and the arts among the people. Awake in us also a keen desire to increase our understanding while we are in this world, and an eager longing to reach that endless life where all will be made clear. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. A reading from the Wisdom of Solomon. Listen therefore, O kings, and understand. Learn, O judges of the ends of the earth. Give ear, you that rule over multitudes and boast of many nations. For your dominion was given you from the Lord, and your sovereignty from the Most High. He will search out your works and inquire into your plans. To you then, O monarchs, my words are directed, so that you may learn wisdom and not transgress. For they will be made holy who observe holy things in holiness, and those who have been taught them will find a defense. Therefore set your desire on my words, long for them, and you will be instructed. Wisdom is radiant and unfading, and she is easily discerned by those who love her, and is found by those who seek her. The multitude of the wise is the salvation of the world, and a sensible king is the stability of any people. Therefore be instructed by my words, and you will profit. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The psalm appointed for today is a portion of the 21st psalm, the first seven verses, which are found beginning on page 608 of the Book of Common Prayer. Psalm 21, verses 1 through 7. The king rejoices in your strength, O Lord. How greatly he exults in your victory. You have given him his heart's desire. You have not denied him the request of his lips. For you meet him with blessings of prosperity and set a crown of fine gold upon his head. He asked you for life, and you gave it to him, length of days forever and ever. His honor is great because of your victory. Splendor and majesty have you bestowed upon him. For you will give him everlasting felicity, and will make him glad with the joy of your presence. For the king puts his trust in the Lord. Because of the loving kindness of the Most High, he will not fall. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus said, no good tree bears bad fruit, Nor again does a bad tree bear good fruit, for each tree is known by its fruit. Figs are not gathered from thorns, nor are grapes picked from a bramble bush. The good person out of the good treasure of the heart produces good, and the evil out of the evil treasure produces evil. For it is out of the abundance of the heart that the mouth speaks. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I tell you? I will show you what someone is like who comes to me, hears my word, and acts on it. That one is like a man building a house who dug deeply and laid the foundation on rock. When a flood arose, the river burst against the house, but could not shake it because it had been well built. But the one who hears and does not act is like a man who built a house on the ground without a foundation. When the river burst against it, immediately it fell, and great was the ruin of that house. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Today we celebrate Alfred the Great, the only English king to be given that moniker, and I think the only English king to be included in the calendar of saints. Born in 849 at Wantage, Berkshire, the youngest of five sons of King Ethelwulf, Alfred spent his life in a time of battle, murder, and sudden death during the Viking invasions and settlement in Britain. He was deeply impressed by when, on a visit to Rome at the age of four, he was blessed by Pope Leo IV, and 2 years later when he witnessed the marriage of Ethelwulf to a young princess of the Frankish court. Following his father's death and the short reigns of his brothers, Alfred became king in 871. In heroic battles and by stratagems against the Danes, Alfred halted the tide of their invasion and secured control of the southern and part of the Midland regions of England for the English. After a decisive victory in 878 at Edington over the Danish leader Guthrum, he persuaded his foe to accept baptism. Alfred died on October 26, 899, and was buried in the Old Minster at Winchester. In his later years, Alfred sought to repair the damage the Viking invasions had inflicted on culture and learning, especially among the parish clergy. With the help of scholars from Wales and the continent, he supervised translations into English of important classics of theology and history, including the works of Pope Gregory the Great, Augustine of Hippo, and the Venerable Bede. In one of them, he commented, "He seemed to me a very foolish man and very wretched. Who will not increase his understanding while he is in the world, and ever wish and long to teach that endless life where all shall be made clear?" It's odd to think of Alfred dying at the end of the 9th century, just at the turn of the 10th century. And if you look at the collect that's written for his day, the collect thanks God for bringing Alfred to a troubled throne that he might establish peace in a ravaged land. But the story of his life begins with paragraphs about heroic battles, and his reputation is not only as a preservationist of knowledge, but as of a warrior king who managed to prevail in the various battles of 9th century Britain. Of course, the next 1,000 years would provide plenty of opportunity for the church, for England, for anyone who cared to think about it, to celebrate a warrior king. 1,000 years later, it's uncomfortable to live on the edge of a moment in history when, for the life of the church, it has become increasingly more difficult and less comfortable to pray, it seems, for warrior kings. And we look back at a history that's defined by violence, not only in the world, but in the life of the church. History that's written in blood through a series of battles that deciding who would prevail, what culture would prevail. And the church might say from time to time that we were grateful that peace was achieved, but it was never achieved for long, and the next thing the church would have to do would be to bless an army. As I say, 1,000 years later, it seems to me that perhaps we live at the edge of a time, which is always a difficult place to live, when the church no longer wishes for her, no longer wishes to pray for the success of battles, no longer hopes that the greatest thing that God's people can accomplish will be triumph in warfare, no longer hopes that the path to peace will lead through triumphant battles. And instead, at least speaking for myself, desires a life of prayer that's shaped by the desire for peace. That's won not by conquering every foe, but by actually bringing the heart of Christ, the heart of God, the heart of love to bear into our relationships with one another at every imaginable level. I don't think this was Alfred's enterprise, nor has it been the enterprise of the leaders of the nations for thousands of years. And maybe it's simply naive of me or of the church to hope that peace in and of itself could be accomplished merely through the will and the word of God. I'm willing to give thanks for Alfred. I'm willing to acknowledge that his place in history. And I'm also eager to pray for a different kind of history to unfold before us. And it seems to me that God may be calling his church to just such a thing. So, let us give thanks for Alfred. Let us give thanks for his preservation of learning, of wisdom, of culture. And let us also beware the path that Alfred needed to follow, which was the path of battle and warfare, on the hope that some peace might take hold for a while. But Christ has planted in the hearts of his church now, it seems to me, a desire that peace might actually reign and might be a sign of the dawning of Christ's kingdom. I know it seems unlikely. I mean, what? It's not as though I can point to successes of peace, not many of them, in the world at the moment. But it's not impossible either to suggest that maybe we could lay aside our warring ways, find the heart of Christ, and establish peace. If we are living in on the edge of time, when we need to somehow navigate that edge to find our way into a new plane of existence, where peace is won through the heart of God and not through the triumph of our own warfare, then let it be. And may God help us to strengthen our prayers, to promote a vision of peacefulness that comes from his Sacred Heart, and to do everything we can to see that vision take hold in the world and to usher in the age of Christ's kingdom of love. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Now let us pray for the church and for the world using Form 6 of the Prayers of the People, found on page 392 of the Book of Common Prayer. In peace, we pray to you, Lord God. for all people in their daily life and work.
For all families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth.
For Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury. For Michael, our presiding bishop. For Daniel, our bishop. For Nora, Stephen, Nicholas, and Gordon, my priest brothers and sisters, who worship and work in this place and parish. And for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in his church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, remembering especially to continue to pray for all those who are sick with the coronavirus, for all doctors, nurses, medical workers, and essential workers of various occupations who put themselves at risk in order to take care of others during this time of pandemic. For all those who are unemployed and whose livelihoods are at risk, whose families are in danger and who are worried about their well-being and their careers. For all those who are in danger because of fires in the west, storms in the south, and other natural disasters that cause such havoc. For emergency responders who put themselves at risk for the safety and protection of others. For all those who hunger and thirst for righteousness and who are struggling for justice that's been denied and working to bring about an end to the sin of racism in our hearts and in our society. For all those beloved of this parish community who are sick or in need, and especially remembering at this time Chris, George, Sue, Tom, Kent, John, George, John, Homer, Mary Jane, Marlene, Jen, Suzanne, Tucker, Susan, Joanne, Martin, Roe, John, Lisa, Mark, Miro, and all those others who we remember in the silence of our hearts, praying for peace in our time, for an end to warfare in every corner of the world, for a peaceful political process to unfold in this nation, praying for refugees who have no place to call home, for those who live in great poverty in so many places around the world, for those living in poverty in our own city, for the homeless, the hungry, the lost, frightened, alone, for those who are struggling with addiction or suffering and mental illness, for those who are languishing in prison, for those who have been exploited or abused, and for those who have lost hope. For all those who suffer in any way, in body, mind, or state, hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life, giving thanks especially for the beauty of this day, giving thanks for the rain that waters the earth and the sun that bathes it with its warmth. Giving thanks for the gifts of technology that are brought to us in this parish and throughout the world, and for wisdom to use that technology well. Giving thanks for St. James School, for the welcome table, for our ministry residents, for all those who volunteer in outreach ministries, even during these days of pandemic. Giving thanks for all those who offer their ministries in the church with willing hands and glad hearts. We will exalt you, O God, our King,
and praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom, remembering especially all those who have died from the coronavirus in the past day, and all those whose lives have been taken from them in acts of war and violence in recent days. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them who put their trust in you. We pray you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone,
for our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Of your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Of your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Pray, brothers and sisters, that this, my sacrifice and yours, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord receive this sacrifice of my hands, for the praise and glory of his name, both for our good and for that of all his holy church. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in Jesus Christ our Lord, you have received us as your sons and daughters, made us citizens of your kingdom, and given us the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you've made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with blessed Mark the Evangelist, with blessed Alfred, and with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are we who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God.